Do you like IKEA?
Yes.
Do you like building computers?
Yes.
Do you wish you could take the joy of building IKEA furniture and marry it with the joy of building PCs?
Yes.
Aha. Well, then do I have the case for you. This is the Cooler Master Cube 500 flat pack case. This case comes completely disassembled. And as you move through the instructions that Cooler Master provided, what eventually is revealed is a fully built PC with components and everything. It may sound tedious, but I was pleasantly surprised at just how good of an experience I had building both the case and putting all the components inside of the Cooler Master Cube 500. And if this case appeals to you, as does the idea of building a case, this may be the right choice for you for a future PC build. By the way, stay tuned until the end of the video to catch all of the information on performance benchmarks, airflow, and gameplay benchmarks. And if you like getting all of the latest and greatest information on newest cases and PC parts, why not like and subscribe so you know when videos like this are gonna hit the channel. Okay, so maybe the idea of mixing IKEA and enjoyable in the same sentence isn't really the right combination, because I don't know about you, Brian, but building IKEA furniture makes me want to punch a puppy in the face. Okay, that's not true. But it does make me really mad. I mean, who could hurt puppies? In the arms of the angel. The Cooler Master Cube 500 is the latest case from Cooler Master, and for a case that costs just under 90 bucks, it is surprisingly versatile. There are a lot of options in how you can configure this case, but we went with the basics and did a $2,000 budget 4K rig, which I know, but it's budget 4K. Understand that means something. And we powered it with an AMD Ryzen 7 7700 and the Radeon RX 7900 XTX. That's right, all flagship when we talk about that GPU. Let's check it out. The snafu of a slightly bent piece, which is a word of warning if you have to order this case to ensure you don't have the same issues 3/4 of the way through the build that I did, you may just want to just make sure that all of your stuff is, you know, not bent. Other than that, I will say that the experience building this was surprisingly smooth. Before jumping too far, we should check out what we put inside of this PC, which feature both a Ryzen CPU and a GPU. But because I wanted to keep the cost low and the PC powerful, we are cooling it with a Deepcool AK500S, which is why we went with the non-X SKU of the Ryzen 7 7700. This keeps it easy and cheap to cool, but still gives you all of the performance and gameplay power of the Ryzen 7 7700 without overclocking and with far less power, which means much, much easier to cool. So let's kick off our benchmarks with checking out the airflow of this case using our visualization and smoke. Now, this is going to be a pretty non-standard setup for fans, because this build we're going to be pulling air in from the bottom and having the two fans at the bottom suck it up into the GPU and then into the Deepcool AK500S and out through the rear Li & Li 120mm AL fan in the back. Now, if you wanted to add a thinner front intake fan, you could absolutely do so. But I know that given what GPU and CPU we were going to be using in this case, we're going to have no issues with cooling. Speaking of cooling, let's just see how well this meticulously planned build did in the CPU and GPU cooling department. I mean, I pretend I know what I'm doing when I plan these builds, but let's see if it actually comes to fruition. So for underload, it looks like I was right. Thanks, Brian. And I had no reason to be concerned, because we saw our CPU hit an average of 72 degrees Celsius with a GPU hitting a nice and cool 61 degrees Celsius. However, for the first time in I don't know how long, we actually saw an increase in temperature in gaming, with the CPU actually averaging 75 degrees Celsius when gaming, with the GPU staying just where it should be at 61 degrees, which is normal given the GPU is gonna be under load. Nothing at all to be concerned about, but a bit outside of the norm to see CPU actually be warmer when gaming versus when it is under load. But at sub 80 degrees in both cases, who cares? That's awesome. So thermals were good, but before we jump into gaming benchmarks, let's talk a little bit about the build experience. First, my experience with cases that need to be assembled have really only come from one company, which is Thermaltake. And if you watch a few of those builds, which we have some live streams of, and you know what, it honestly took me 45 minutes just to put the case together, I was hesitant about getting the flat pack case from Cooler Master. I have never been more happy to be wrong. You can tell that Cooler Master really cared about the build experience, and by combining the unboxing experience, so as you take it out of the box, with building the PC was actually a pretty genius move on Cooler Master's part. Beyond that, it is worth noting that it does have some of those weird quirks that come with little tiny cases, especially if you're going to be doing an AIO cooler inside of this build. Also, I am not the biggest fan of having the PSU be inside of the main chamber of the case with all of the other parts. I mean, our build did come out looking, it wasn't as clean as what I normally built. And I'm not sure saving a few bucks to build it yourself or even the flexibility of the case was worth it to me for the cost savings. But that's definitely up to the eye of the beholder. It might be a thing that you're like, I really like the way this looks, and that's totally okay. I had a good time building the PC, but I wasn't perfectly content with the end product when I got finished. But that's my opinion. And if you love the look and you're excited about this case, then don't let me dissuade you from building it. It's fine, it's absolutely awesome. Okay, so given all of that, how does the build that we actually built inside of this, the $2,000 build, perform? Well, let's kick it off with Cyberpunk 2077 at 1440p with ray tracing and ultra and FSR 2.1 set to balance. We saw Cyberpunk 2077 sitting at 81.10 FPS. Very respectable for an AMD card, and if you pop things up to 4K, you should see 60 FPS, no problem, though you may need to drop down to medium ray tracing. Sorry, it's an AMD thing. Next up, we have the Forza Horizon 5 at 1440p with graphics settings set to extreme, FSR 2.2 set to auto. We saw 191 frames per second. Again, 4K not gonna be a problem here. For Call of Duty Modern Warfare 3, again, 1440p, extreme graphics, FSR 2.1 set to balance. We're sitting at 240 FPS for the single player campaign. And I'm guessing if you wanted to play MP at 1440p, you're gonna get north of 260 FPS with no upscaling and using low visual settings to maximize frame rates. And again, 4K, again, not gonna be an issue whatsoever. Way to go, 7900 XTX. For Shadow of the Tomb Raider, 1440p with the highest graphical preset and XeSS set to balance, you're looking at 215 FPS. Remember, there is no FSR here, and Intel is GPU agnostic, so again, yay for Intel helping out AMD here. Finally, rounding out our single player games, we have Tiny Tina's Wonderland with graphics set to badass and FSR set to balance. We saw 220 FPS. That seems pretty badass. For MP titles, we kick it off with Apex Legends with graphics maximized for competitive gameplay. We saw 293 frames per second at 1440p. And finally for Fortnite, again, graphics set to competitive gameplay to maximize frame rate. We saw an almost unplayable 393 FPS. Almost 400 frames per second, Brian. So for $2,000, this system crushes at 1440p, and if you wanted to make the leap up to 4K, you totally could. And absolutely have no issue given the combination of the Ryzen 7 7700 and the RX 7900 XTX, which is, in this case, doing the majority of the work, the GPU. So a nice low-cost 4K rig in both gaming and in certain workstation situations for sub $2,000. But enough about what I think. Enough about us telling you everything. What do you think? And what did you think of the build? What did you think of the case? Does this appeal to you? Do you like building IKEA furniture? Would you like to go take this to IKEA and build it at IKEA? You're weird. Now, while you're down there, make sure you slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring that notification bell so you get a notification each time we post a video like this right here on Robitech. Also, if you have questions or you want to discuss builds or talk about the flat pack Cooler Master Cube, head over to discord.gg/Robitech, and you know what? Take a discussion. Maybe make a friend. Making a friend is awesome. Also, feel free to reach out to me on all the other channels at Robitech, absolutely everywhere. That is it for me. Thanks for watching. We look forward to seeing you on the next episode.